Well, let's turn now and look at the humanitarian situation, because Anthony Lake is the chief executive of UNICEF and he joins us live from New York. We are very grateful for your time here on BBC News. Every time we get an assessment from the UN, it seems to be a bleaker position on the humanitarian side. What is your current assessment of where we are as we speak now?
Well, as we speak now, we're in a far worse position than we were a year ago. 10 times as many refugees outside Syria as there were a year ago. Today, 2,500 children will be crossing the border, leaving their homes and hopes behind them, although we haven't given up hope for them. So the situation is deteriorating. It gets worse every day, and the world has to do something about it.
And those are pleas we've heard from the UN for such a long time, and yet we hear from Oxfam today saying that some of the donor countries, for your record appeal that you've already made, are failing to come up with the cash. How surprising, how disappointing is that?
Well, it's of course disappointing, but I think we have to not just focus on what has many donors, including the British government, have been, as Oxfam says, relatively generous. We need to focus on the fact that the past contributions that we have received, and at UNICEF, our appeal for 2013 is something over 50% met, which means we still have very large needs of some almost $200 million for the remainder of this year. That those contributions have led to achieving a lot of results. Thanks to our very brave staff there and our partners there, we have immunized over 2 million children. We have brought water and sanitation to over 10 million people. That is not enough to meet the needs, but we need more generosity, more support, especially from those governments that have not yet done their fair share, so that we can deal with what is a, and looks likely to be, a worsening crisis.
Just briefly on this point, because our Prime Minister David Cameron has been talking quite a lot in the last week or so about humanitarian corridors, pushing that particular aspect to this humanitarian response. How urgently are they required on the ground?
Well, we have two problems here. One is the access from across the border into Syria, carried out mostly by non-governmental organizations, and then within Syria, crossing the lines, we are working to go from government-held areas into opposition-held areas to meet the human needs, and we're negotiating those just about every day. As we speak, we are trying to get 1 million textbooks into the schools that are still open, where 1 million children await them so that they can get back.
Just in terms of another aspect of this, because there is so much pressure on neighbouring countries, Lebanon, Turkey, Jordan, in terms of that refugee flow, a couple of organisations here, the Refugee Council and Refugee Action, have been urging our Prime Minister to do more to take some of those Syrian refugees. Is that something that you would support, a call like that, that actually more refugees could go further afield?
Well, everything that any government can do throughout Europe and elsewhere, of course, to relieve human suffering is important. But we have to keep focused on what is needed in those countries that are bearing the greatest burden. Just think about this. Half of the children in Lebanese public schools now are coming from Syria. So we need to focus attention on how to not just help in the immediate future with those kids in these overcrowded classrooms, but also use the opportunity to build a better public school system in Lebanon itself. In the camps in Jordan, you can see now the kids who should be learning for their futures are now drawing pictures of war, of atrocities, things no child should ever see. And we worry very much that we're losing a whole generation of children in Syria who in 10, 20, 30 years from now are going to be replicating the violence because of what's happened to them now.
And clearly that is why you're working...
the future is at stake as well as the present.
Sure, which is clearly why you're working so hard and have been for such a long time. Isn't the basic problem that you face, though, until you stop the perpetrator, you won't stop the refugee flow?
Yes, and I hope that by making it clear that these are not just statistics that we all use, these are individual human lives, that those parties responsible for the carnage and all of those who can put pressure on them to stop it will be all the more motivated. We're seeing now in the headlines, in the Security Council debates, et cetera, as your program was just showing, a focus on what do we do about the chemical weapons. We need to focus also on the victims of those weapons and all of the victims of all of the weapons and all of the fighting that is not only destroying lives now, but as I said, is destroying the future of Syria and threatens to destabilize the region for a generation to come.
Well, let's finish where we started. If it is not, if there's not some sort of resolution in the next 6 months, 9 months, 1 year, what do you envisage?
I envisaged, I don't know of a word worse than a catastrophe, because it is a catastrophe now. I envisage a lot more human suffering, a lot more strategic setbacks for the whole region. And as I and my colleagues and other UN agencies have been saying, enough.